Hello, everyone, and welcome to the panel, which will be discussing wound infection in humanitarian emergencies. We are here together to reduce infection. We have over 900 people who have subscribed to this webinar today from over 65 countries from all around the world. Welcome to all of you. What is IRP? And why are they hosting this webinar? It's about effective wound care in humanitarian response and disaster settings. It can be achieved with relatively simple measures and have important mortality and morbidity benefits. It's about sharing of good practice, the best practice, and innovation to help reduce wound infection in environments specific to humanitarian emergencies. I want to thank specifically today as well the panelist organizations for partnering with IRP and helping to promote the event, the IRFC, the WHO, and MSF. Thank you so much for being with us and for supporting us. It would not be the same without you. Then, of course, I want to thank the host of today, Infection Reduction Partners, a cross-sector collaboration of humanitarian aid organizations, governments, agencies, and healthcare professionals, working together with an evidence-based approach to reduce wound infection rates. And of course, the partners and supporters. UCS Group supports procurement and logistics of healthcare products into over 100 countries with NGOs and government agencies. We have Balmain Medical, logistics and distribution to International Red Cross and Red Cross Crescent members globally. And last but definitely not least, Aid Connect, an online platform that makes it easy to build and monitor your USAID pipelines. Thank you so much for your support and for partnering with us. It could not be the same without you. Of course, I need to thank all of you, dear audience members, for sending in generously all your questions for this webinar. We will, of course, try to get to your questions, but do not be mistaken, we have already a lot in stock for you, and I'm looking forward to it. For the audience members that sadly cannot make it up until the end, do not despair, because we will record this webinar, and the webinar, as well as the guidelines and protocols which will be mentioned throughout this webinar, will be available on the website of IRP, which is www.infectionreductionpartners.com. Now, let me go over to the stars of this webinar, our dear panelists. I will start with the esteemed Dr. Veen. Dr. Veen is a specialist registration general surgery in 1992 in Holland. He did in 2002 his specialization in the UK and 2005 at the Fellow Royal College, Edinburgh. It's the oldest college in the British system. His surgical practices are quite impressive. 1992 to 2003 in the Netherlands, 2003 to 2006 NHS in Shetland, 2006 to 2012 the British Royal Navy in Gibraltar, 2012 to 2017, Chief Surgeon, International Committee of the Red Cross in Geneva, 2017 to 2018, Lead Surgeon, ICRC, I'm sorry, for Complex Attacks Preparedness, 2018 onwards, WHO Consultant for the Emergency Medical Team Project and the WHO Academy, from 1992, yearly surgical missions in war zones, which also right now he's calling in all the way from Equatorial Guinea. So we're really delighted to have you here, especially because with Wi-Fi and everything, it must not always be very easy. Then focus during the recent years was quality of care in the humanitarian setting. And his hobbies are cycling, previously competitions, music, classical piano, of course, beautiful like my son, reading. He's always wondering about current and past events in the world and individual acts of people. When I asked him why, Dr. Veen, why are you joining us today? He said, because we need to change the narrative and alternate the message to really put the emphasis on first patient, then wounds, patient management with wounds. Thank you so much. Dr. Veen, please introduce yourself a little bit to us as well.
Thank you very much for this opportunity to talk about this important subject, wounds in humanitarian disasters. They are different and they demand a different approach. We see far too many unnecessary complications. Now here, Equatorial Guinea, 1 week after the explosion, we are removing sutures that should not have been put last week, and patients have unnecessary wound infections. But yes, we're not talking about wounds, we talk about patients. And also patients in humanitarian emergencies, they go through extra misery. They need a good resuscitation, and only sometimes specific wound treatment is part of the resuscitation. For instance, if there's a C problem, stop the bleeding. But important message, in these situations, all wounds are contaminated. And due to late presentation of patients or late arrival of assistance, the wounds are infected. And these wounds need to be cleaned thoroughly. They need to be surgically cleaned, a debridement. That's an operation under anesthesia. And there should be no primary closure of wounds. But we'll talk about that later. Now, traditionally, humanitarian assistance is not very good with the focus on quality. And since 10 years, the WHO really is trying to assure a better quality with the Emergency Medical Team Initiative, defining the minimum standards. If you go below that, you're going to do harm. And those minimum standards are about staffing, about equipment, about training, about procedures of emergency medical teams. And we're in the process of verifying emergency medical teams, but we're also in the process of sorting the operational support and assisting governments with the coordination if a disaster happens. And part of this emergency medical team initiative is the wound treatment of the victims in the disasters. And I'm very happy this webinar is a very good opportunity to touch on some important messages. And let me simply repeat them. It's good patient resuscitation. It's wound debridements, a real surgical operation. It is no primary closure. And to deliver good quality, whether you're out there or at home, for the best outcome for the patients. So far, my introduction. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Veen. It is an absolute pleasure to have you here. And it's just really impressive that even during times of corona, as we all know, you know, life goes on and there's still a lot of disasters happening. And I'm so grateful to have people like you that go out and get done what needs to be done. So thank you so much for your service. Now, before going over to our dear Kim Delahunty, something I also wanted to mention quickly is that please do talk about us on the different social media channels. There's different hashtags, hashtag prepare to protect, hashtag IRP webinar, hashtag medical response, and hashtag humanitarian emergencies. Please do use these hashtags and follow IRP on the different channels. Thank you so much. So let me go over now to introduce our only female panelist today, but she is just a rock star. Just looking at her bio and talking to her before is just really inspiring for me as a woman as well. So we have Kim Delahunty here, who has been an infection preventionist in academic and private hospitals since for over 20 years and is currently the owner of Delahunty Infection Prevention Clinical Epidemiology Consulting after working as the Administrative Director of Infection Prevention and Clinical Epidemiology at UC San Diego Health for 16 years. She currently is the IPC Advisor Referent for Médecins Sans Frontières, so MSF, Doctors Without Borders, for all USA projects in 16 countries. She has been a leader in infection prevention in nationally and internationally. When California Senate Bill 739 and later 1058 and Senate Bill 158 were introduced and became law, Kim, as chair of the committee, acted as a strong advocate for patient and a clear, strong voice for the infection preventionist. Because of that hard work, she was the recipient of the APIC's 2012 Hero in Infection Prevention Award. Kim is a tireless advocate for education of the infection preventionist, as witnessed by her role as the co-chair of the CACC Foundation's Advanced Training Program, as faculty for the APIC Ambulatory Surgery Center, ASC, Infection Prevention Course, EPI 101, and a National CIC Review Course. She has worked internationally, most recently established an outreach program for Japanese infection preventionists. She also co-authored an oncology chapter in the recent APIC text, as well as many peer-reviewed journals on infection prevention and clinical epidemiology, emerging infection disease, and IP in resource-poor areas. She is an international and national speaker. As a San Diego and Imperial County APIC chapter member, she has held the offices of membership chair, president-elect, president, and past president. Mrs. Delahunty serves as a member of the California APIC Coordinating Council and has held officer positions of president-elect, president, and past president. She has served on the APIC Practice Guidance Committee. She served as an APIC liaison for the HRET, AHRQ, ASC Surgical Site Infection Prevention Project. Mrs. Delahunty received her Bachelor's of Science degree in Nursing at the University of Phoenix and her dual master degrees in Business Administration and Healthcare Management at the University of Phoenix. She has been certified in infection prevention since 2003. One thing I really like about her is her philosophy statement: create a safer world through prevention of infection. When I asked her why, Kim, why are you here today? She says, share my passion and knowledge and good practice. It takes a village to take care of all kinds of circumstances. Kim, the floor is yours. Please introduce yourself.
Thank you. Hello, everyone, and it's a pleasure to be here with everybody. And I want to thank IRP for reaching out to MSF, Médecins Sans Frontières, Doctors Without Borders, to get our insight and our expertise on this very important topic that Dr. Veen had already started to discuss. Médecins Sans Frontières and Doctors Without Borders, for those that aren't familiar, is a private international association and was founded in 1971. The association is made up mainly of doctors and health sector workers and is also open to other professionals who might help in achieving its goals and aims. Our mission is to provide life-saving, safe medical care to those most in need, with the hopes of returning them back to their communities. As MSF members, we agree to follow these following principles: medical ethics, independence, impartiality, neutrality, bearing witness, accountability, and behavior of commitment. This is our charter, and I feel that this actual webinar falls in line with what we're trying to do at the front line with our projects in regards to wound management and preventing wound infection. Our main goal, and my main goal here, is to put the patient first and make sure that we're discussing the patient and making sure that it is a safe environment for the patient as best that we can deliver. We can't always do everything perfectly, but we can always improve on care. And as Dr. Veen said, these surgical wounds are very complex, different than what you may see within your own hospital systems. That doesn't mean that infection prevention and control cannot happen. And we can do better at that. And we can help the healthcare team by giving science evidence-based information and recommendations and help support the teams in giving our patients better care in a humanitarian setting, which is not just about the wound or the hole in the patient, but it's about the whole patient. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kim. It's wonderful to have you with us today. I'm going over now to our third panelist, Dr. Pascal Cassan. Pascal is the director of the GFARC and National Medical Advisor for the French Red Cross National Society. He has a PhD in medicine from the Faculty of Medicine Salpêtrière in Paris. He is an active member of the French Red Cross since 1977, where he started as a first aid rescuer. Then he joined the European Reference Center in 2002 as coordinator. His experience and international fame in the field of first aid has also led him to train and educate many French celebrities. On top of this, Pascal is a member of many resuscitation and emergency councils, such as the International Liaison Committee on Resuscitation. His expertise on first aid has led him to push and contribute in many titles in emergency medicine and first aid. Since 2010, Pascal has led the team in charge of creating and reviewing the IFRC's International First Aid and Resuscitation Guidelines, which are updated every 5 years. When I asked him why he is joining us today, he said he's interested to see and link science with practice. Dr. Kassan, it's a pleasure to have you today. The floor is yours for your introduction.
Thank you very much, Tessie, for this kind introduction. Good evening, good morning, everyone. First of all, I want to thank you, Infection Reduction Partner, for organizing this very interesting webinar. And as the director of the Global First Aid Reference Center of the International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Society, operated by the French Red Cross and located in Paris, I have the pleasure to work on evidence-based and, of course, in the field of wounds and especially the role of the lay people. We work with all the 192 national societies of the Red Cross and the Red Crescent to harmonize practices in first aid techniques and training, as the Red Cross and the Red Crescent teaches more than 20 million people from the general public each year and all in all communities. And thanks to our 200,000 trainers. The importance of today's topic is fundamental, as wound care is an integral part of all first aid programs. These wounds are relevant to our daily lives, as well as to exceptional situations, such as disaster or crisis situation. Fortunately, wounds are common injuries seen by first aid providers. They don't usually require emergency medical care. They may include wounds such as laceration, puncture, wound, or abrasion. But these wounds, when they are more serious, can also cause hemorrhage and thus a life-threatening emergency. Also, there may be a risk of infection, including example of bacteria of tetanus. And first aid measure can greatly limit the consequences of these wounds, such as applying pressure for a bleeding wound, or applying a tourniquet in the event of serious bleeding in a crisis situation, but also simply avoiding infections by washing hands and the wound by using simple disinfection products. I was mute. Sometimes effectively limited to water and soap. All audiences in the community are concerned, especially the citizen and his family, but also vulnerable people such as refugees and people with limited resources. So thank you really again for this opportunity to share.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kassan. It's an absolute pleasure to have you today. So now I will go over to our presenter who will give the keynote address just in a moment. Dr. Gerald Klein is the former professor of clinical medicine at University of California, Irvine. He is an expert in infectious disease and wound infection prevention. He is on the board certified allergy clinical immunology and board certified pediatrics. He's the founder of SDCRA, Full Service CRO, which was sold to Quintiles. He is former SVP at Quintiles, now IQVIA, former founder and EVP Pathway Diagnostics, former Chief Medical Officer of Talikris Biotherapeutics, Grifols, former founder and CEO of Entera Health, GI Company, currently founder and principal of MedSurgy Pie, LLC, it's about product development and medical affairs company, being a board member of multiple organizations, editorial board of numerous publications, author of one book, textbook chapters, and numerous peer reviews publication, which won his most recent one in April 2020 was an article titled Recognizing High-Risk Traumatic Wounds and Preventing Infections and Complications. When I asked Dr. Klein why he has joined us today and why he gives the presentation is, for him, it's prevent infections in emergency situations during times of large-scale disaster. Dear Dr. Klein, the floor is yours.
Thank you. And I'd like to thank everyone for attending today on our webinar on wound infection prevention in humanitarian response. The webinar objectives and outline. The learning objectives are wound infection prevention in humanitarian response, the role of irrigation in infection prevention. We should treat the whole patient, not just the hole in the patient. The outline of the webinar is the problem of wound infection, the current guidelines to prevent wound infection, irrigation as a key component with comparative data, and then we'll wrap up with a call to action. Acute traumatic wounds have a big infection risk factors. It depends on the wound type, the cause, the location. For example, lower extremities have greater risk. The size and depth, larger and deeper wounds have a greater risk of infection. Tissue borders with irregular jagged edges are more likely to become infected, as well as the deeper depth of tissue layers involved. Contamination with a microbial insult, of course, is a big problem. Foreign bodies just complicate wounds. And time from injury to treatment is critical. You should start treatment immediately. The quality of the cleansing and debridement irrigation is critical. Another important factor is the patient's underlying condition. For example, if they have diabetes, then it's a more complicated situation and they're more prone to poor healing and infection. The next slide list a few more photos of different types of traumatic wounds. Environmental risk of wound infections. The available supplies and resources are very important. The working area must be kept clean. Hand hygiene is extremely important and the use of gloves. There might also be cultural and social barriers that you'll have to penetrate. It's important not to reuse single-use items. For example, needles. This can spread hepatitis. You must also get the patient engaged and educated about their situation. Follow-up is critical to prevent morbidity and mortality. Again, some additional photos. Consequences of wound infection. The action taken pre-hospital have very significant impact in preventing infection later. The impact on the patient is poor healing, infection, biofilm formation. It could spread to deeper tissues, causing necrosis, enter the bloodstream, and cause sepsis and death. Here are some additional photos so you can really understand how these wounds can get very complicated quickly. The consequences of wound infection. A decreased quality of life for the patient. They could have loss of function of a limb, amputation, or permanent disability. This all increases morbidity and mortality. It could have a tremendous impact on the family and their livelihood. It could have a detrimental impact on healthcare teams, outcome and metrics, including increased occupied beds and increased financial strain on limited resources. Sources of contamination include the environment, whether it's the soil or debris, contaminated water, or sometimes the poor air quality. Cross-contamination should be avoided with being careful about the skin, the body's normal flora, or contaminated equipment. The common bacteria we see are staph, MRSA, Pseudomonas, Enterobacter, E. coli, Klebsiella, Acinetobacter. Key guidelines and protocols for acute wounds. The International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies, the International First Aid Resuscitation and Education Guideline 2020. The WHO, Management of Limb Injuries During Disasters and Conflicts. Global Guidelines for the Prevention of Surgical Site Infections. Doctors Without Borders, Medical Protocol, Wound Care Protocol. Key points from the guidelines for wound infection prevention. Hand hygiene is critical. You want to prevent contamination. Cleanse the hands with liquid soap or alcohol-based cleaner before and after wound care, and if it becomes soil, cleanse hands after removal of gloves. Treatment area cleanliness is critical. Clean all surfaces prior to care with a disinfectant. Do not let people walk in and out of area during wound care. This is an increased cause of infection. Maintain a sepsis. Do not cross-contaminate. Again, maintain a clean, dry area for wound care. Wear non-sterile gloves and change if they become dirty or contaminate. Of course, use sterile glove for surgical care. Use a disposal apron or gown if available. Do not touch supplies with dirty hands or gloves. You don't want to contaminate them. Do not use expired supplies. Keep packages closed and clean. Do not reuse single items and properly clean and sterilize reusable items. Wash and cleanse the surrounding skin. Use liquid soap on intact skin. You may also use povidone iodine soap or a 75% solution. Rinse with sterile water or normal saline on skin surrounding the wound. And now, if we look at this diagram, we see on the right a contaminated wound. The dark area is particles and debris, and the yellow stands for microbes. So the initial debridement removes large visible particles and debris to clean the wound. So you see there's less yellow and black particles. Then mechanical debridement is essential. For small little wounds, you could use gauze, but you may need surgical debridement to remove all dead, contaminated, infected tissue. And quite often severe wounds, you have to use general anesthesia and surgery to remove all this material. However, we still see in the last diagram, there are still microbes present. So a final irrigation of the wound, usually with an antiseptic solution to cleanse and remove the visible debris and to kill some of these microbes, they're still there. Wound dressing as appropriate to the wound type. Dress the wound if there's no excessive swelling. You have to control bleeding. There should be no active bleeding. Keep the wound bed clean of the visible debris. A non-woven compress covering to prevent sticking to the wound. And again, the dressing is dependent on the wound type. Key points from the guidelines about irrigation. The International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies, the International First Aid Resuscitation Education Guidelines 2020. Clean the wound and cover it to increase healing and reduce the risk of infection. The WHO, Management of Limb Injuries During Disasters and Conflicts. Volume is important. Irrigate with a volume between 3 and 12 liters of fluid. Topical antibiotics are not effective and leads to more antibiotic resistance. These should be avoided. Systemic antibiotics cannot replace cleansing and surgical debridement of wounds. Doctors Without Borders, the wound care protocol, the decision to apply an antiseptic or not, or to start a systemic antibiotic or not, will be taken based on the wound classification by the medical team. The purpose of effective wound irrigation. What is a wound irrigation? It's a steady flow of solution across an open wound surface. Why should you irrigate the wound? You want to remove debris, you want to reduce overall microbial load, and you want to hydrate the wound. The goals of this wound irrigation: you want to reduce infection, promote healing, prevent local and systemic complications, help restore a patient's quality of life, decrease morbidity and mortality rates, reduce health costs, and reduce strain on the healthcare system. Sterility of solution is key. The volume of the fluid is like the solution to pollution is dilution, is an old saying. Pressure of the fluid is also another important aspect. The optimum pressure in numerous studies is moderate pressure. If you apply too much, it could force bacteria in the wound bed. If you apply too little, it fails to adequately remove enough contaminants and debris, thus inhibit wound healing. So don't just pour it on the wound. The type of devices are a compression bottle, bulb syringes, and a spike bag. And again, moderate pressure should be employed for acute wound irrigation. Antiseptic solutions. The concentration, as I mentioned, is very important. If it's too concentrated, it could be toxic. If it's too dilute, it will not be effective in killing organisms. If you mix your own solution, you have a potential for contamination and the potential to make it either too strong or too weak. Pre-mixed solution, if possible, are the best ones to use. The dwell time is also important in order to kill the microbes. Antiseptic irrigation does not replace large volume saline irrigation. Antiseptic irrigation is typically used as the final rinse to lower microbial loads. Wound irrigation choices. If you use water, you should boil it to prevent contamination. Saline. It has no antimicrobial properties. You should use large volumes of saline under pressure for initial removal of particulates, debris, and some bacteria. And again, in the diagram, we see as you use these irrigation solutions and debridement, you reduce the particles and the bacteria. However, they're not all removed. Antiseptic irrigation with povidone iodine or chlorhexidine gluconate can kill microbes on contact. Use antiseptic solutions to further lower the microbial load after debridement and saline irrigation. It's especially important in acute traumatic wounds and humanitarian emergencies due to the high risk of infection. Deep traumatic wounds often expose subcutaneous muscle and bone tissue. So we look at the safety of these antiseptic wound irrigation solutions. Povidone iodine is broadly available in different concentrations for topical use, extensively for minor cuts and scrapes and for surrounding skin antisepsis. It is not safe for subcutaneous use. Do not use in open wounds, and it's toxic to wound healing. Now, it is non-sterile and not packaged to deliver under pressure. It's frequently diluted, which may cause contamination and inaccurate concentration. Chlorhexidine gluconate is also widely available at different concentrations and soaps for washing hands and skin antisepsis. Do not use the higher percentage in open wounds. Diluted solution is not sterile and has irrigating detergent agents. It is, however, available in the 0.05% premixed with no additives. It has extensive data in the 0.05% CHG is safe and well tolerated to multiple tissues and burns. It's available as a sterile packaging device. It is available as a compression bottle for pressurized irrigation. The efficacy of antiseptic solutions on bacteria and biofilm. Bacteria. 0.05% chlorhexidine gluconate and 10% povidone iodine are both effective against microbes that cause infection in traumatic wounds after only 1 minute of dwelling time. Povidone iodine, however, is inactive, activated in presence of organic material such as blood. CHG has the unique ability to bind to tissue proteins, leading to prolonged activity, and is not deactivated in blood. Biofilm. A recent study from the Mayo Clinic showed that chlorhexidine is capable of eradicating staph from biofilm in vitro and in clinically relevant concentrations and exposure time. Povidone iodine and others were not able to do this. There is no data on the use of antiseptic solutions specifically in humanitarian emergencies. However, 0.05% chlorhexidine has been used extensively in high risk, high infection and surgical wound procedures, showing infection reduction of up to 50 to 80% in such areas such as orthopedics, colorectal, plastics, reconstruction, ileostomy, and C-sections. 10% povidone iodine has also been used extensively on dermal wounds as well as diluted for surgical use. However, a recent 2019 orthopedic study done by Hart and his group at the Mayo Clinic with over 12,000 cases uses diluted 0.25% povidone iodine and demonstrate no infection reduction when compared to saline. Commercially available antiseptic solution such as 10% povidone iodine under the brand name Betadine. This has been cleared by the FDA for minor cuts, scrapes, and burns. Chlorhexidine gluconate 0.05% under the brand name Iricept has been cleared by the FDA as a device for wound debridement and cleansing. It is sterile packaged in 450 milliliters volume, premixed for optimal concentration and pressure. And it's been used in over 2 million procedures for a broad array of wound procedures. The next steps are call to action. We should engage all the staff in a multidisciplinary commitment to understand the implications of wound infections, to download and share the foundational protocols and published guidelines, understand the benefit of effective wound debridement, irrigation, and wound care. A call to action, a cross-section collaboration to share and build evidence, to build evidence specific to acute traumatic wounds in humanitarian response settings, and for global collaboration to evaluate innovative interventions that are supported with evidence from other sections and sectors. We have references listed here on the next two slides. However, if you haven't memorized all these references, there are links for the guidelines that are available to get them. I thank you all for your kind attention.
Thank you so, so much, Dr. Klein. That was really incredibly, incredibly interesting. And I surely have learned a lot from your presentations as being someone who is not 100% on the field as all of you are. So thank you so, so much. Again, this presentation as well will be available on the website of the IRP later. As I can see, some people in the chat have asked for the presentation. I'm sure the team of the IRP can accommodate for you to receive this presentation later. I have also been asked, before I move over to the panelists' questions, which is our second part of this webinar, if there will be questions asked during the questioning. Sadly not. We have a full stock of questions already prepared for you. There will be 6 questions in the first chunk, 2 questions each panelist, and they have 3.5 minutes for each question. Then if we have time for Question part two, we have three extra questions, and then question part three, if we still have time, for some of your questions that you're asking in the link, and also some of the questions that you have been sending in prior to the start of the webinar. Of course, if you feel like that your questions have not been answered entirely or not at all, because there were different questions, I am sure that if you write the IRP or go on their different social media hashtags and ask your question then, that someone of the team will get back to you. No one is left behind. So let's go over now to the second part of this webinar, which I was really excited as well after this fantastic keynote address from Dr. Klein. Thank you again. We will start this Q&A with Dr. Veen, if I may. And my question to you, Dr. Veen, is, it is well agreed that poorly managed wounds are associated with high mortality from sepsis and crush syndromes. What, in your opinion, are the principles of basic wound care in disaster situations that should be implemented, especially when resources and expertise are limited? Dr. Veen.
Thank you. So the essential principles, as I said, surgical debridement and no primary closure. But it's very important to understand why these wounds are different. In disasters, there's often a lot of crush injury in earthquakes, in storms. People are thrown about. The wounds are heavily contaminated, open fractures, but a lot of dead tissue is present. If you speak about ballistic trauma, penetrating injury in conflict, gunshot wounds, then there is an extra factor of energy transfer, bullets that tumble inside the body and kill the tissue and cause a temporary cavitation and a permanent cavitation. The temporary cavitation causes a vacuum, and that because of that, extra dirt is sucked into the wound. And the permanent cavitation is an area in the wound that is full with dead or not yet dead tissue, which is a perfect culture medium together with the contamination. And that will end in disasters if that is not handled properly. The problem is that you not always see it. Sometimes with the penetrating trauma, you see only a small wound, and this needs to be surgically explored and extensively debrided. And sometimes the condition of the patient does not allow to do it all in one go, and you have to do serial debridements. And no closure, primary closure of wounds. You can do that only after a couple of days when it's clear that the wound is clean enough. These debridements are not at all easy operations, especially if bone is involved, to judge which tissue is viable, which pieces of bone will be able to survive, and not to do too extensive a debridement and make huge defects that will not heal. That's a skill that has to be learned, and it's actually a skill that is not taught in a normal surgical training. So I would encourage everybody to have a look at that publication that we did with WHO and ICRC, the management of limb injuries in conflicts and disasters. It's online, it's free accessible, anybody can download it. And it's really, we put those things that we knew for decades, but we try to have a panel of military experience, humanitarian experience, academic backup, and to put it clearly into guidelines. And have a look at it, the management of limb injuries in disasters and conflicts. We chose to start with the limb injuries because that's 80-90% of the patients when you go into a humanitarian disaster, because the patients, regrettably, with truncal injury, they mostly die because we are too late with the assistance. So patient resuscitation, good surgical debridement, and no primary closure of wounds, and no internal fixation of fractures in the initial phase. And let me just add a few words on antibiotics. Antibiotics are important, but they do not replace the surgical treatment of the wounds. What kind of antibiotics? For the contamination, actually, you can do small spectra. Traditionally, we use penicillin. If the patient come in late with heavily infected wounds, then it's not just the gram-positive anymore, then it's the gram-negative and the anaerobe as well. So you have to go broad spectra. And there are beautiful protocols in place from MSF, from ICRC, from WHO. If you go in the field with an organization, be prepared, have a good look at those protocols and decide which one you're going to use and don't improvise on the spot. And as a final remark, please don't forget tetanus prophylaxis, crucial. So far my comments.
Thank you so much, Dr. Veen. Also, Dr. Veen, if you would look quickly on the chat. Also, for the other panelists, when you're not speaking, do check the chat sometimes because there's questions for you there as well, just that we accommodate everyone a little bit. So thank you so much. Really interesting points. With that in mind, I want to go over to Kim, please, with my next question to you. When considering innovations from the private sector to reduce infections with acute wound care, what are the top three product features that are key to consider when evaluating applicability for use by first responders in emergency and disaster response situation? Kim, floor is yours.
Sure, thank you. I think before we even go into the three key factors, we need to make sure that, as Dr. Veen has suggested, that people are aware of what those protocols are, that they're educated to those protocols, and that they get competent in within those protocols. We, again, cannot always have the exact type of supplies that we would like or the exact type of dressing. However, we can always do things better and more aseptically. So the three components in innovation are going to be, in a humanitarian setting, in my opinion, is going to be something that is cost neutral, right? Because we are limited in our resources. And a lot of times we have the supplies, we just have to educate the actual frontline medical staff on how to use the supplies and that the supplies are actually there. So I would say cost neutral is very key in humanitarian settings. And the importance of having a packaging that is easy to use, the instructions are easy to use, everything is there for you, so that it's kind of a grab and go type of a setting that you don't have to determine, okay, is this the top, is this the bottom, how do I put this on, how do I, you know, so having that tutorial and pictures are really key, especially with translation across different countries. And then the third would be something that is going to be effective. So science evidence-based recommendations on effective products, on effective tools and techniques that really do help decrease surgical site and wound infections. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kim. Really interesting. And I took some notes. I will also recap everything all of you say later in my concluding remarks. So I will go over now to Dr. Kassam, please, with my next question. More often than not in humanitarian emergencies, first responders and volunteers are the first to be in contact with the wounded in the field. Humanitarian agencies are keen advocates of first aid training and community engagement as part of enabling and improving the effectiveness of wound treatment. Apart from training, what other tools and procedures can and should be implemented in the field? Dr. Kassam, the floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you, Tessie, for this question. Very interesting one. And it completes the previous answer. Indeed, the first responder is always from the community, and he or she has to take care of these wounds in a simple way, and sometimes with a minimum of material, as we underline on the chat. In order to train communities well and to avoid the practice of bad gesture, it is essential to provide trainers in the field with recommendation in line with scientific evidence to really link science and practice. To this end, the International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies, with the help and collaboration of the international organization, such as the International Liaison Committee on Resuscitation, European Resuscitation Council, publishes International First Aid Resuscitation and education guidelines. Every 5 years, to the attention of first aid program designers, program managers, education and scientific committees, and also the trainers. These guidelines are available on the IRP website and also on the Global First Aid Reference Center website. And it's very clear that then the application of these guidelines will have to be translated by the implementation of contextualized tools, such as the first aid manual, but also educational tool that will have to be used by the trainers. The guidelines don't replace first aid manual and associated education material. Instead, they serve as the foundation resources for first aid program designers to develop their first aid material, such as manual programs, courses, learning apps, or digital products now, public information and associated educational material. National societies should use and adapt the guidelines according to their local cultural, linguistic, technological, environmental, and legal context, including the local prevalence of injuries and illnesses. That's very important, and the flexibility is very important. The adaptation must also consider the population capacities and available resources. In addition, the guideline provides scientific evidence for first aid program managers and designers to make strategic decisions. Last and not least, the implementation of communication campaign is also very important, because indeed, in order to train a maximum of community members, it is important to spread messages that make people understand that the first responder is often a family member or a person very close to the victim. These messages have a main objective: to develop the confidence to act of this first responder, especially from the wounds, because they are so often on the daily life, but also during disaster life. It's very important that the lay public will be able to do something before the professional. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kassan. Really, really interesting. And I do agree with you that often, especially in conflict zones, that the first responders are indeed close family members, and the guidelines should also reflect that they can use them with their knowledge of what they can do. Absolutely. So thank you so much for that. I will go over again to Dr. Veen with another question to you, which is, what is the influence of oral antibiotics, so systemic, on wound infection rates? Is there a preferred antibiotic that humanitarian responders utilize in emergency situations? Dr. Veen, please, the floor is yours.
If the antibiotics are needed, you better give them systemic. As a prophylaxis, again, they are not treatment. The treatment is the surgical debridement, it's prophylaxis. The patients come from outside, so it's mostly not resistant strains. That's why you can be small spectra at the beginning. No topical antibiotics. There were several questions about it, but we don't use it, and it seems not to be good. If in the hospital setting the wounds get reinfected, then it's not a matter of starting to culture wounds and change antibiotics. No, that patient needs a re-debridement. It needs another surgical cleaning. And as I said, the choice of the antibiotics, you don't have to make that up yourself. Just have a good look at the protocols of the recognized institutions like MSF, WHO, ICRC. They're good protocols and use them as such. But therefore, oral antibiotics for the wounds, I don't see a real reason for it. Either the patient won't need it, it's not serious enough, or it's not efficient enough because it's too serious and not topical. So systemic antibiotics for the patients with serious wounds that that then undergo the surgical treatment. The antibiotics is just adjuncts. One question I'm on also about the rinsing of wounds. Yes, we believe very much in the rinsing of wounds, but you've seen how critical it can be that you can do harm with wrong concentrations. Therefore, in the field, we actually stuck very much to the safe procedure of use drinkable water. If you can drink the water, then it's safe. If you're not sure, you cannot guarantee that the concentrations are not right and you can do harm, then better be on the safe side. So in most humanitarian settings, we actually revert to drinkable water for the irrigation of wounds. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Veen. My next question is to Kim. There's so many amazing questions and I could ask them all, but this one I think matches well what we were talking about already and it's a good continuation. So what are the various spectrums of wound impairment and how do they differ based on the nature of catastrophes? Are there any life-threatening infections involved that humanitarian responders should be better adept at addressing? Kim, the floor is yours.
Hi, thank you. This is a very important question as well. And a lot of the different variety of wounds in the humanitarian setting are going to be addressed differently. But in infection prevention and control, we should really be handling all wounds in a standardized way. We should be doing asepsis, sterile technique when it's appropriate, not reusing supplies, making sure that the environment is clean, that we're doing hand hygiene, and all of these prevention measures in between each patient, not going from patient to patient to patient. And in a humanitarian setting, it can be difficult, especially in a catastrophic event, to do that. But we aim to do that as best that we can. Some of the things that I don't think we take into consideration around the infection piece is that we can do really great emergency care and respond very quickly. And then sometimes we forget about the patient after that event. Where are they going? What is the environment that they're going to return to? Are they the breadwinner for their family? Are they able to provide that, that support to their family after we've had them at our facility? And so we really need to look at the patient as a whole again. And the quality of the care. It's great to run in and have emergency care, and that's why we're there. But we can also do those things better. We can learn the new standards, try to standardize across organizations so that we are all doing similar care for these patients in the environment that is challenging, and that there's no perfect answer to that. The other thing about the infections and the humanitarian response, prevention of infections is really the same, regardless of the organism. And so we want to make sure that we have those infection prevention and control strategies in play, that people are aware of what infection prevention and control is and their responsibility, because it is everyone's responsibility to help prevent infections. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kim. And now I will go to the last question of Q&A section one, which is addressed to Dr. Kassan, please. In 2016, the IFRC published a guideline on first aid and recently published a 2020 update to this guideline in an effort to provide evidence-based guidance for first aiders. What has been the result so far? And what can be shared in terms of best practice for wound treatment that truly make a difference during an emergency? Dr. Kassan, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Tessie, again. Yes, very clearly, we published on February 2021 a new version of our guidelines. And it is not a revolution on wound care, but it confirms the evidence-based recommendation for use in the field. As far as simple wounds are concerned, we can highlight a few elements. First, some guidelines who have a lot of evidences and some good practice point that it's we have no so many evidences, but it's also interesting. As guideline, we have for the simple wounds that it should be clean with potable clean water preferably from a tap to provide pressurized water flow, as Dr. Klein underlined in his presentation. And after cleaning it, covering the wound with tape, hydrogel, film, or hydrocolloid may decrease wound size and redness and increase healing. As good practice point, we have some other point. If no clean water is available, use a disinfectant to clean the simple skin wound and advise the person to seek medical help if possible, if you suspect they are not sufficiently protected against tetanus. And if the skin around the wound becomes red, purple, or darker, and is warm and painful, or if the person develops a fever, of course, advise them to seek medical advice, as this is an indication of infection. Of course, for severe wounds, other elements are highlighted. In the case of a complete amputation, to prevent tissue damage, the amputated body part should be wrapped in a sterile compress or bandage and placed in a clean, watertight plastic bag, which is then sealed firmly. A second plastic bag containing water or ice can be used to preserve the body part. The first bag containing the part may be placed in the second bag containing water or ice. There should be no direct contact between the body part and the ice. That's important. The first aid provider should ensure the amputated body part is brought to a medical facility with the person. And in the case of a partial amputation, immobilization of the limb is good in a normal anatomical alignment if this is possible. It might not be possible if the limb is fractured or dislocated. That's a problem. Of course, for bleeding, the most important guidelines are first aid provider should use direct manual control for life-threatening external bleeding. That's the most important. And if direct manual compression is ineffective or unable to be performed, first aid provider may use a tourniquet, especially for severe life-threatening external extremity bleeding, and especially in disaster aspect or crisis aspect. And if a tourniquet is used, manufactured tourniquet is preferred. An improvised tourniquet is less effective than a manufactured tourniquet, but may be applied. Is all that is available for severe life-threatening external extremity bleeding. If the direct manual compression is ineffective and a tourniquet is not practical, available or appropriate, an hemostatic dressing may be used for severe life-threatening external bleeding. The hemostatic dressing should be applied with a direct pressure. Just to finish, and last but not least, first aid provider should not use pressure point for severe life-threatening external bleeding. It's very clear that it's ineffective and dangerous. All these guidelines and all the other on first aid are, on, of course, to be found online in the document published by IFRC and available on our website. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kassan. This concludes the first section of questions, and we do have time for more extra questions, so I will go over to that straight away so we can answer as many as we can. For that, I will start with Kim. Kim, what, in your opinion, are some of the critical challenges of managing wounds among survivors? And what practices have the potential to minimize preventable deaths and improve the outcomes and quality of life among survivors? Kim, the floor is yours.
Thank you. I think we've alluded to it in all of our different question and answer sections, and also in Dr. Klein's PowerPoint presentation at the beginning. But just to reemphasize that there's lots of some of the people in the chat have asked, are there guidelines? Yes, there are definitely infection prevention and control guidelines. The different organizations, my organization, MSF, has some very good wound care guidelines, but also general IPC, infection prevention and control guidelines, but the WHO has them. They are online, and you can refer to IRP for the resource page. But we also want to make sure that we're considering, when we look at the difficulties and the critical challenges of maintaining the wounds, it's not just the hole in the patient, it's the whole patient. So it is safe medication management. It is all of the wound management that we've heard today, the debridement, the irrigation, the getting it treated quickly, getting the patient to the actual healthcare facility quickly. That's a challenge. And sometimes they'll go 3-4 hours before they ever get to a healthcare facility. By that time, you know, as Dr. Veen has said, these crucial crushed injuries are already infected. So making sure that we are aware of the evidence and science on what all of that wound protocol is. The challenge is the education and the loss in translation, and making sure that we're giving people pictorials to know how to do the wound care and really spend that time, because that is going to pay it forward for the next patient and keeping the patient safe. We can do things better. We're doing great work, don't get me wrong, but we can always do things better. We can always improve hand hygiene. And just by doing that, actually will improve outcomes. I know it seems simplistic, but it is true. There is science and evidence to support that. So again, it takes all of these things to look at the whole patient, making sure we're giving them the best care that we can with what resources we have and the knowledge that we have. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kim. So we have another 3 minutes left. So I have for one question for Dr. Kassan, which you have 3 minutes to answer if that's possible. What are the dominant complications in acute wound management? What have been the challenges during emergency surrounding wound management, and how can humanitarian responders better address them? Dr. Kassan, the floor is yours.
Yes, thank you. In fact, the main complication of wounds are, of course, as we said previously, the risk of bleeding, when it is an important wound, and of course the risk of infection for all the wounds, including the smallest one. And that's the most important to teach to the lay public. It's effective even when you have a small wound, perhaps you can have an infection. It is clear that the training of humanitarian workers must therefore emphasize the urgency of stopping bleeding by simple local compression, and above all, with regards to wounds, respecting the rules of asepsis, as we said, washing hands, washing the wound abundantly, possibly using antiseptic product when we have, and monitoring the evolution of any wound in the absence of redness, head or pain. According to the chat question for the last minute, I can say that in our guideline, we have a special paragraph about isolated situation and when we have few resources. That's important for those who ask this question. Go and see and read the adaptation to the environment of the IFRC guideline, because you will find some answer concerning, of course, wounds, but other first aid situation. One example, for example, if you have no water to wash hand, you can use ash, because effectively it's a possibility to wash hand with just the ash, and it's one thing, but we have many other possibility and proposition in remote area or a low resource situation.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kassan. So this concludes all the Q&A for today for the webinar. We have concluded section 2 of this webinar. And thank you so much for your amazing contributions, for answering all of the questions I had, and apologize already for all of the questions we could not answer, because we do know that we have quite a lot of questions, namely some of these as well that have been sent in from the audience members prior to the webinar, and of course the questions which I could see in the chat. Again, please do send your questions to IRP and to the speakers, and I'm sure someone will get back to you or go through the guidelines and through different websites, as they have mentioned, in order to find the answers there. My concluding remarks. I took some notes over this webinar, and I will start with Dr. Klein. We have learned about the sources of contamination and its consequences. We learned about key guidelines and protocols for preventing and treating acute wounds. The key points from our partners, of course, about irrigation depicted by the IFRC, WHO, MSF. We learned also about the purpose of effective wound irrigation, the goals of wound irrigation, and its solutions. He calls for engage all staff, multidisciplinary commitment, and global collaboration and dialogue. Then we go over to Dr. Veen, who urges for surgery climate, especially in conflict areas, talking about bullet wounds, especially, and its effect on the human body, the urges of no primary closure of wounds in order to make sure they are properly healed before closing them. The choice of the antibiotics goes with choosing the right protocol. And he said, he mentioned as well, that again, the panelist organizations, IFRC, WHO, and MSF have all their protocols, which are all available online. He talks about rinsing of wounds in humanitarian settings to go with local water resources if possible. If you can drink it and it is clean, you can use it. Going over then to Kim. Kim was talking about the three components of innovation, the cost neutral as number one, cost neutral as we are limited in our resources. Number two, the importance of having a packaging that is easy to use and understand with pictures. Totally agree with you on that. Something and three, something that is science evidence-based on tools and techniques, on protocols. In a humanitarian setting, she says, in emergency care, we sometimes forget about the after event, the care. We need to also look at the patient as a whole. Is he the bread carrier? How will he access these resources after he has left the emergency care, and so on. So then we go last but not least to Dr. Kassan. Dr. Kassan was talking essentially to link science with practice, as he mentioned already as the why he is joining this webinar in the first place. The tools need to reflect the guidelines. The guidelines do not replace the first aid manuals. National societies should use guidelines according to their language and adapt to their needs and available resources on the ground. He urges that the first responder is often a close family member. Hence, the guidelines need to be also understood by people like that, that don't always have the education. Guidelines, so he talks about the IFRC, which also you find online. It should be clean with portable water and after cleaning, cover the wound. As a good practice point, if no clean water is there, of course, seek advice. Direct manual control is needed for bleeding and use of tourniquet if needed, especially in crisis aspects. First aid providers should use pressure points and use, if available, an antiseptic protocol. More on that, as stated again, on the IFRC website, where you can find more on these guidelines. This was all for my concluding remarks. And I'm sad to say we have concluded this webinar for today. And so it is my time now to thank the panelists for their most generous time to be with us here today. Dear Kim, it was a pleasure to have you here. Dr. Kassan, Dr. Veen, and of course, Dr. Klein for the most interesting presentation at the beginning. The guidelines and protocols referenced in the webinar can be downloaded, as I mentioned at the beginning, at the website of the Infection Reduction Partners, as you can see here on the screen, www.infectionreductionpartners.com. Together we can reduce infection. The video of the entire webinar will be available on the YouTube channel of IRP's channel. So if you go on YouTube, IRP YouTube, you will find that as well. Finally, please keep an eye out for the following four new workshops that IRP is planning. On smaller follow-up workshops specific to open fractures with orthopedic trauma specialists. So all of that and more on the website of IRP. Of course, please do as well, as we have heard from the panelists, go on the website of the IFRC, Médecins Sans Frontières, and the WHO, where you will also find more details on their specific protocols and guidelines. I hope you enjoyed the webinar as much as I did. I certainly learned a lot, so thank you so much. Please do go on the different social media tags and on the website of IRP for more information, for more questions that you have not answered, have not gotten an answer today. And I hope you have a beautiful rest of the day. Thank you so much for joining today, and all the best.